Hello, everybody. Hello. Is our technology working?
Yes.
Is it working too hard? No. Okay. I'm Jane Allison, director of creative writing, and this is the best event of the year. Tomorrow also, so two best events of the year. Commencement is almost the best event of the year, and I'll probably say that too when I'm speaking, but it won't be true because this is better. Degrees are nice, but this is all about the poems and the poets and the peers of the poets who have read their poems, and I think a good deal of parents here as well. So let's hear it for the parents above all. I'm not a poet myself, but I write other things, and I have a pretty good idea that poets are not any easier to live with than other kinds of writers. And probably rearing them is hell, I don't know. So congratulations, parents who have created these poets. So I think we mostly want to hear what they're going to read to us, and I want otherwise to thank two people who make everything that happens here happen so well. Time and again and again, and we know who they are. They are Jeb and Barbara. Yeah. And I think I'm going to stop right there and welcome our first introducer of our first poet. And they're going to name themselves and then do their thing. Okay. Off we go.
Hi everyone, I'm Quinn. Last week, Courtney Flerage found a dead bee on the deck at Rita Dunn's house. She held the bee, examining it in sunlight. She tried to convince us that this insect's corpse was a thing of beauty, worth careful attention. What was beautiful to me, though, was watching Courtney as she studied its soft hair, the flecks of pollen on its delicate wings. It is this quiet observation, her ability to find magnificence in any small thing around us and somehow make it otherworldly, that pulses her poetry with life. Through Courtney's meticulous and inventive language, her poems transform the physical world into spiritual havens. As nature becomes tinged with danger, or her scope explodes outward into the vastness of the universe, her poetry leaves room for the praise within loss, the divine within devastation. She names the earth thoroughly, species of moths, the particular touch of a plant. Her work delves into the incommunicable aspects of personal relationships and what it means to have a human voice in the wilderness of a forest, hurricane, or apartment balcony. As Courtney's poems explore the natural world, they remind us that we, too, are wanting animals. Courtney herself is just as thoughtful and open as her poetry. She is always there when you need her to identify a bird call. She showed me my first mockingbird, taught me that fruit wants to be eaten, sat on the couch with me late Saturday nights searching photographs of dahlias and cosmos. She is the first person I tell when I learn a strange scientific fact or have an existential crisis about the inevitable end of the earth. I think of her when I see a nest or a mushroom. Courtney and her poems attune me to the environment, remind me to consider my place in it. It has been a pleasure getting to know her this year through her writing and her friendship, both singular and important. Please join me in welcoming Courtney Flerage.
Before I start, I just want to take a minute to say a few insufficient thank yous. First, my parents are here today, Fred and Margie, and I just want to thank you both for your endless support and also for raising me with science and nature as a companion in understanding the world. I want to thank Jane and Chris and Jeb and Barbara just for organizing this wonderful, miraculous thing that we do and advocating for us always so that we can focus on poetry and fiction and writing. And I want to thank Greg, Lisa, Debra, Rita, and Paul, my writing mentors, just for being so generous with your time and always being there with an open door. And also to my peers, I see all of you in the poems I'm about to read, so thanks. So speaking of mothers and nature, I'm going to start with a poem called Guide to Small Mammal Rehabilitation. Guide to Small Mammal Rehabilitation. He is not a pet. He is not your forest marvel. The cottontail kit, blind and unhearing, finds you from your cat's slack mouth. Lend him your carnivore's warmth, crook of shoulder and neck where he burrows, touch thirsty, needing the pulse there as the blood winds close to surface, where you prove to him you are no predator. Each morning, your mother sings a familiar warning. Darling, learn to love more loosely. Give him your breath, the formula bottle's soft nudge, your long hair an acceptable nest. It's an old story, bodies wanting other bodies. Decades ago, doctors tried animal blood for transfusion. It was, they thought, more pure. Once, you told yourself you could live with longing like a thistle in your thumb, ground in, splintered off. Already he is waxing wild, veering into thickets. See how he heals himself, dark eyes budding, droplet bright. See how he unmakes you, his miracle. Love poem ending. The metaphor is familiar. Two lightning bugs shudder and spark after each other, their whole lineage based on this necessity of meeting in the dark. But tonight the girl goes out with her flashlight and holds it low to the ground, flickers the beam as a female would in her flightlessness, draws the males close. Try not to think her cruel. Yes, a handful of them don't meet, but the field is still full of brightness. There will be thousands of warm nights like this one, millions of the beetles, this whole darkened face of Earth erupting in brief constellations. Wasn't it Caravaggio who powdered up the flickering bodies to glaze his canvas in desire light deadened? Last night was so humid, the air of the barn dampened the swallow's mud nest until it dropped from its rafter and the nestlings spilled out. The girl, wandering, found them alive, softened into the wet earth. She thinks all broken things are hers. She thinks she can save anything. And why shouldn't these ruffled bodies, so much lightness, also be hungry for what glitters in the trees as if willing? In the morning, she'll wake to the birds' stiff, empty bodies, and to survive this poem, what is essential is to forgive her for force-feeding the birds even after they had stopped begging. Forgive her for not knowing the syrup of the firefly's lit abdomen is a quick poison. Forgive me, please, for wanting something beautiful to last longer than it should. A brief history of near disasters. November, a storm blooms over the Atlantic. The cat is chewing the finish off our door frame, restless, kept inside too long from the rain and the great horned owl my mother thinks may live in our woods. Yesterday, she found a possum's head untethered in our yard, white rabble of spine glowing in the chickweed. Smart bird, to remove the bits that hinder flight, to crush the bones, make compact. Over the sea, the storm blasts open, rips to land, fades a little as it curls up the Chesapeake. A man at work asks again if I'd like to get coffee, and I tell him no, because though I think he is kind, he is not careful, because I know what he likes is that I am a still doll around him. And wintering down, blue crabs nestle deeper into the estuary's silt. Ships swell against the docks, fastened tight, but do not topple. We name the hurricane like a child. We keep it that close. After the attack, the possum becomes a tithe of itself. And the owl, all night, morning, love whom you will.
So this next poem just requires a tiny bit of background, which is, it's addressed to the barred owl, which is native to Virginia and Maryland, where I'm from, but it's actually invading in the Northwest. So while it's a bird we love here in the Northwest, it's actually causing those native birds to die out. So this poem starts with an epigraph from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
The experiment will remove barred owls from parts of up to 4 study areas in the northern spotted owl's range, using lethal and non-lethal methods of removal, and then monitor the effect of such removal on northern spotted owl population trends. The service plans to begin some barred owl removal this fall. To the barred owl. I don't know what a dead owl is like. A gun, a dog, a decoy, a luring in, some felt shadow. These days, I dream as I think you might, of warm bodies pulsing beneath snow, morning hours slept through straight. See, I'm writing as if I've lost you already. Before the trees strip bare to cold, I learn them like a lover's hands, how their bark catches. Beech smooth and hitched, ash diamond-ridged, ironwood in ungiving twists. And once my father planted a chestnut sapling, though we knew it would blight, and it did. Mycelial fan, yellowed blisters, cambium choked. Insomniac, I know you as my bright bird, who stayed after the warblers and finches left, made songs long since forgotten until spring, their brains, yes, that efficient. Call me hypocrite, in denial, tight-lipped. Some days I think I hear as you do. Winds creak through night woods, frogs freezing in their puddles, something weeping.
So I have, this is my Virginia poem. I knew I needed to include a Virginia poem. So this is, Virginia is for lovers. Or for red buds flaring in early spring. Or for wood thrushes echoing in the forest's throat. For monarchs migrating, their small bodies of bright poison. For the birds that ignore them passing through. For brown dogs and their happy mouths. For green snails lipping stream beds, scraping algae off rocks. For even this small hunger. These days, I'm so in love with wanting because for a while, my heart was a clenched fist. For the ginkgo tree almost lost to us, which seemed extinct until we found a few hidden in a monastery. For those few that flowered into themselves to repopulate the earth. For the tender, sour fruit it drops, for its fan leaves that erupt in gold. Let all things be singular, a song and burning. And this is my last poem. It's a little longer. Thank you all for coming. To my upstairs neighbor after spider. I knew the black widow on sight by her stance, hanging ankles in a web strong irregular, venom resting softly in its ducts. She resting softly between the railings of my balcony. Sam, neighbor from the balcony above mine, she probably would have stayed there if we'd left her alone. I've known widows more dangerous by the way they crawled into shoes to keep warm or hid in the boxes of my attic, sharp and ready, broken ornaments. But here was illness in the open, bold where I could see it, and I didn't want to be alone when I killed her. So you came with bleach and paper towels, and we sprayed her until she spooled to the concrete. We watched her flail, waited for her to die, looked over the railing at the city below.
the train tracks and the hospital, the mountains you must see every day like I do. Sam, from the balcony above mine, at night I can't see the stars above me because your balcony is in the way. For the last meteor shower, I had to find an open patch of grass between buildings and lay there with a friend you don't know, because we don't actually know each other at all, except that now we've killed a thing together. And sometimes you drop things, heavy things that thud on my ceiling, and also at night you play jazz music so loud it bounces off the buildings nearby and swells over the train. It's just you up there listening, alone, or I imagine it is, because it's just me in my room when I listen. Sam, from the balcony above mine, you are very loud at living, but the meteors were not musical at all when they fell. Just a streak and flicker or a sharp flash sideways. The stars, too, were silent as always as I learned their names between flares. The summer triangle, Altair, Deneb, and here, Vega, fifth brightest, who will become our North Star in 12,000 years because the Earth sways on its axis, though the Vega we see could already be dead and is, certainly, like all stars, dying. A pretty design, you, Sam, from the balcony above mine, said of her ruby hourglass, and then I think it's suffering, as she writhed beautifully, delicately, such a small thing making a big deal of its death. Her faithful parts were shutting down, a seizing in her spindles and sleek needle limbs that knew how a web could be cast, how prey could be wound in gossamer, dissolved and sipped, which I imagine tasted sweet to her, or at least nourishing, and didn't feel like anything horrific. When it was over, you folded her up in a paper towel because crushing was unnecessary, her body now uninteresting, a clump of sugars that wanted to be something else for a while, and were. I learned later that she could have lived as long as 3 years, which is longer than many kinds of birds, and longer than I've ever kept love alive with someone else. Though, of course, I didn't tell you that, Sam. Stranger from the balcony above mine, your life 10 feet above me each day. Sam from the balcony above mine, the room above mine, stars and constellations have nothing to do with each other, except that when we see them from Earth, trembling, lucent, and singular in blackness, we want them too. Thank you.
I'm Landis. I'll be introducing Veronica. Last fall, Veronica took a landscape architecture course, and after a few weeks of reading her poetry in Debra Nystrom's workshop, I could see why the subject fascinated her. Landscape architecture is the point at which ecology, design, engineering, botany, and psychology converge in order to build an experience into the natural world. It is both artificial and organic. As you will wander along a garden path, as it meanders past poisonous milkweed and under plump magnolia trees, you experience a narrative of small incidents. The architect constructs an unnoticed odyssey that leaves the visitor at the end with a new and subtle feeling. It is ultimately the art of sculpting an atmosphere. This is how I experience Veronica's poetry, a mapped wilderness full of delineated fervor. There's a beautiful tension between the fierce energy of her subjects that wish to proliferate and the reticent structure of her language. When I read them, I feel her transforming the world around me, leading me to a destination I can't imagine. In her last poem in Rita's workshop, Veronica reimagined Wallace Stevens' anecdote of a jar. In the poem, she lifts the glass from the hill to find an ecosystem rich with unaired life. The poem is the perfect ars poetica for her work. Each one of her poems feels like a small opening, a glimpse into a distant place. With an intense gaze, she always finds the miraculous and the surprising. These poems are revelatory as they unearth the poetic and the scientific, locate the body in a lawn of St. Augustine grass, or find the human by studying the architecture of a pharmaceutical company in Switzerland. As a poet, she is generous to all her subjects. This is also true of her as a person. This spring, she let me visit her poetry class, and instead of just observing, she had me lead workshop. She was happy to let me try out teaching for the first time, happy to give her students one more perspective on their work. Her class showed me how much she values all perspectives and aesthetics. This inclusiveness is key to understanding Veronica as a poet and as a person. Nothing around her is without poetry, nothing too small to be noticed and made extraordinary. Please join me in welcoming Veronica.
Thank you, Landis, and thank you for all my mentors, Rita, Paul, Lisa, Debra, Greg, and of course, Jeb and Barbara, who helped me with the last minute teaching crisis, even this morning. So, that introduction was really great, because I think it will help you guys. When I was reading the poems, I sort of figured that actually none of them make sense. So I'm trying to put in as many inside jokes as possible with my family, and hopefully that will work out. So the first two are about plants, and the first one starts with a quote by a Brazilian landscape architect, Roberto Bruno Marx. And so that's, a plant is a living being with its own strong requirements, but for a small price, it repays us through its dynamic processes, flowering, bearing fruit, shedding leaves, and even by dying. 3.75 plants to the dollar. The plants became currency. In this way, they gained worth. I used a plant with the property of color to buy a plant with the property of structure. The structural plant waved many glossy thorns, each with their own tiny volume that accreted into largeness. Space thickened around its stem. I imagined the structural plant communing with other structures of the same being, rooted in a row, just touching thorn to thorn until they formed a great leafy dam through which bits of sunlight extruded. That energy could fuel vast machines, clicking out faces on cotton fiber, these faces unleashed upon the city. I imagined leaning on the dark side of the structure, where branches created an arbor. Then I would be part landscape and not an apex. The plant would gain the property of shelter, the property of homeland. I lie immobile, sensing inner flux for several seasons. I become a resurrection of demolished rainforest and flourish wet, fungal, like a stock market. Insufferable plants with their property of time, growing a lifespan beyond the human. If you let them, they inundate every room. So the title of this one is in French, and it's from Voltaire, and it translates to, we must cultivate our garden. On occasion, my brain would dissociate from the requisite action as simply as a hand motions towards the watering can. I was thinking about crumbling basil in a dying mouth. I wanted to promise smooth passage. I know most herbs communicate their states of injury with fragrant gashes that compounds an envoy to fellow leaves, makes them staunch their buds, the way my inner ear registers distinct air deformations as a scream. And like that, I've thought screaming. I killed the basil on the windowsill. So what does that make me? Quintessential American yard. It's serious. On our arrival, dead grass, yet another new phenomenon. Winter lawns like chapped lips, mononet of rhizomes. The plots require constant grooming, a mower purchase, some phonetic negotiation, yar as suited to our mouths as an overripe plum. San Agustin, patron of brewers and sore eyes, becomes a warm season species with wide, flat blades, broader than Bermuda, but more tolerant of shade. Come spring, we lay out fresh sod, enjoying the beautification. This means bathing to San Agustin. Soon the dirt turns hot and cracks like a dish from the oven. We get down on our knees, inspect for weeds. House with Spanish vocabulary. The label above the kitchen's door frame says kitchen. The label pasted to the orange says orange. The label sewn on the sock says sock, no calcetine. Your goal is to conflate the pairs. So bañera melts into the bathtub like a bar of soap, but even more integral, a soul binding to its fleshy carrier. In this house, two bird populations with diverged throat pipes mate and trill constantly. They weave nests from scraps of labels. One label says nest or nido. Gray droppings make nido almost unreadable, a sign that labels whittle like waves against the brain's limestone. The labels are restless. Nestlings create unearthly hybrid chatter. Outside, your mother busies at naming ferns. So Landis mentioned the pharmaceutical corporation, and my mother actually went with me when I got the tour of this place. Inside jokes, yay! So there's actually two poems about this, and I'm gonna read the first one now and the other one a little later. It was pouring on the grounds of the pharmaceutical corporation. At least Wi-Fi also poured from the trees, as did whispers. Who is speaking or is no one speaking, but climate or a loop of bees and cloud, their coordinates sifted through algorithm and as traceable as gas. Also up for question, where hide the lab rats? At the pit of a maze, but the maze is unseen. Hold up the validated badge for entry. They'll stay outside in the acoustic garden. Admire red modular bricks aggregated into a heart, not symbol, but built muscle, with anatomical chambers and valves the size of two entwined humans crouching. These are symbols of labor, but also embodied here in a hive structure named the opera. They in hiatus and severed from their tinned hum in the trees, it rains. Also, it is winter, which means flowerless. Why keep those bees with such a meager rub against dripping birches in monoculture pollinated by wind? So this one is also based on that same Brazilian architect. And Le Corbusier was an architect and urban planner who was really fond of straight lines, which is what you need to know for the purposes of this poem. And so when he built, he went on a tour of Brazil and he was really struck by the meander, so like the rivers. And he was sort of talking about how great it was that they streamed out eventually and how that was like the path to human progress. When he designed a building in Brazil, the same landscape architecture designed this path that kind of makes a little river through the winding river through the building, or in the garden of the building. So this is kind of the river speaking back to Le Corbusier and thinking a little bit about that. The meander. Who knows the ways I form? There are various theories, of which I know very little. I carve into the ground, my life's flow eroding and breaking, froth of process, deposition around a dry neck begets birth, chopping off into the oxbow lake that scars and sends no letters. And you say I am in your image, that life seeks me. As though at humanity's zenith, terrain becomes certainty unblemished, like the cool joints of skyscrapers. For you say heaven is tessellation, for to say otherwise is savagery. For savagery cannot catch light through its irrational vines. Look, another bend, incipient. So this is actually one that was not in the thesis. I wanted to read it so that some people would get new things. But unfortunately, Rita, you get nothing new. Articulated space. The white between one verse and the next being unnecessary, I wanted to push a cereal box mess of typography toward and off the right margin. Who even thinks about the breadth between buildings and what lint gathers in it? I hear many scholars do so, and the starlings constantly smacking juice against clean glass, delicate pollution seeping into offices. Some claim the breath talks back like a vision. It says whatever the mind most desires to hear. Fine, I confess, I cannot resist my pneumatic obsession to harness air, to shoot a nail gun. But I won't open any window. I can be nothing between. I pretend that this is itself an achieving. So this is the last poem, and it's another pharmaceutical corporation poem. So it was pouring on the grounds of the pharmaceutical corporation. The rain, an IV drip, completely unlike that. Still, the rain needles. Your guide jabs towards oncology research centers, old production lines, further across the river, many past and present zones, grants, bridge, hospital bed, scabs like strawberry seeds from failed sticks, how the sausage is made, or where the sausage is made, the making folded in patents, the patents inside some cabinet, the cabinet past some hallway, to the right, a building cluster, celestial mollusks, use exists as aesthetic material, your material is blood, red chemical hangs in the drip, nettles at the confluence of you and it. Take a castle in Italy, soil ground from extinct corals, bacteria excreting pigment, mouse tumors turned to snow, snow melting, you standing in another phase of water, you capable of standing, risk cardiac toxicity in the product's shadow, you happy to be anonymous, to be an end in all this weather. Thank you.
I'm Michael, and I'll be introducing Caitlin Neely. It was early last autumn, playing softball in the vast floodlit fields off Barracks Road, where I truly got to know Caitlin Neely. We had been in workshop for a month or so, but it was there every Tuesday night during our cohort's brave attempt at intramural athletics that our relationship began to grow. I played shortstop, Caitlin second base. As the weeks passed and I read more and more of her poems, and we turned double play after double play, I began to notice what was so special about her and her poetry. On the diamond, as in her poems, the quiet grace of girlhood, I saw a poet whose language was so precise she could write lyrics on her glove between pitches, lyrics that would still have the kind of complex cunning and beauty of her poetic kin, poets like Plath and Dickinson. Caitlin's poetry is sparse, but that is not to say not full of love and longing, moments of rapture and deep contemplation. Her poems are masterfully lyrical and so often surprising. She knows when a moment has been given enough life to move out into the world on its own, to resonate deeply with her reader. In her poem, A Walking Toward Creation, she asks us in a voice so earnest, do you know miracles? Do you know your body? It's uncomfortable questions. Language has gone terrestrial, she cries, mountains cutting through our bones. Caitlin is a generous poet in that she leaves so much room for us in the white spaces of her poems. These are hollowed out places where an utterance of the divine might be waiting in the silence or an invitation of love. In Caitlin's poetry, a moment, a scene, an entire myth or world is whittled down to its most essential elements. The way she crafts them is not unlike a sculptor. Her chisel is her startling syntax, where so much hinges on a comma or dash. And her unique choice of words, words like honeycomb, portico, stalagmite. A Caitlin Neely poem contains so much more than it lets on. Her poems are often written in the persona of mythic females, Persephone, Merope, Nausicaa, but she is not merely telling another's story. She is compiling a universe unto her own that is at once mythic and contemporary. In her poems, her heavy subject matter is so easily made into light. Something is always opening. The earth, your lungs, the ocean, the gap between your teeth. I will close with some of Caitlin's own words. Her poem, Hills, ends like this. Sit with me a while. I have so much to tell you. Ladies and gentlemen, Caitlin Neely.
Thank you so much, Michael. That was a really good introduction to the poems I'm going to read. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad you saw all those things. Thanks so much to my family for being here. Everyone in the creative writing department, Lisa, Greg, Rita, Paul, Debra, I think I got everyone. And then my friends, of course, and everyone, all of my peers. So I like to start off my poetry readings, whenever I have a reading, reading something that's not mine. So two of the lines from this poem are an epigraph to my thesis, one of the sections, and it's called The White Rose by Louise Glück. This is the earth, then. I don't belong here. Who are you in the lighted window, shadowed now by the flickering leaves of the wayfarer tree? Can you survive where I won't last, beyond the first summer? All night, the slender branches of the tree shift and rustle at the bright windows. Explain my life to me, you who make no sign. Though I call out to you in the night, I am not like you. I have only my body for a voice. I can't disappear into silence. And in the cold morning, over the dark surface of the earth, echoes of my voice drift, whiteness steadily absorbed into darkness, as though you were making a sign, after all, to convince me you too couldn't survive here, or to show me you are not the light I called to, but the blackness behind it. So as Michael explained, I wrote a lot of persona poems for my thesis. There's lots of personas in my thesis. So this first one is about Nausicaa. She's from the Odyssey. Odysseus crashes on the island of Scyria, and as she's playing with her friends, he comes out of the trees naked. Yeah, he comes out of the trees naked. And she's the only one that doesn't run away. So she helps him get off the island, helps him find a boat. So this first one is called Nausicaa Asks Her Father for a Ship. There's a gap between two of her teeth where she rests her tongue before speaking. At the edge of Scyria, the sea, the blue of a long sleep, the water full of linen, her body, two wet blossoms opening and closing. She winds the wet robes around her arms, knows to drape them over lotus branches, knows she is beautiful. Odysseus in his nakedness, Nausicaa the only woman whose name he didn't utter. Yes, she did love him, love the way he reached for her hands and touched them, but she's begun to forget even the color of his eyes. She asks her father for a ship, a figurehead of Artemis. She's been told she looks like her. And this next one is about Persephone. If you don't know who Persephone is, she is kidnapped by Hades and taken into the underworld. Eventually, her mother, Demeter, kind of convinces Zeus to let her come up for half of the year. So she comes up during the spring and the summer, and that's why the seasons happen. So when she comes up, everything grows again. And when she goes back down into the winter and fall, everything dies. So this poem is called Self-Portrait with Arm Down the Throat of Hades. So what did you expect? My hair tied up like an empty nest. My naked breasts a room I don't share with anyone. In your stomach, flecks of bone, cigarette ash, coins from the river. You're choking. I want it to be air, a door, a name. Let the field return to a field. Mother in the kitchen, portico mother, doll mother, garden mother. The earth is finally opening. A little world I stick my head into. A walking tour of creation. Once black clouds engulfed the sky, Cincinnati buried in ice, a 7,000-mile-long lake, shore lush with ash and cattail. The mouth of the Ohio opened, heavenly the harbor blued, earth and earth, the fields, river risen. Do you know miracles? Do you know your body, its uncomfortable questions? Language has gone terrestrial, mountains cut through our bones. And this next one is about Florida. I was born in Florida and lived there for like 2 years, but remember nothing of it. And lived in Ohio for like 20 years after that. So this one's kind of my poem to Florida. And it's called Arrival. Up north, I can never remember what sea tastes like.
see memory, see Ferris wheel covered boardwalk, the drive down 75, Chattanooga, Kissimmee, Fort Lauderdale, the waves full of worn bells, whale bones, the far cry of gull, the dark on dark scrawl of landscape, scattering of heron, everything falling, everything shore and flesh. This next one is Sideshow. Every direction treeless, every house I've lived in stacked up like milk bottles. They're watching me from the windows, lined up to catch a glimpse of the girl who doesn't feel, who doesn't cry when the boys tug at her skirt, pull barrettes from her long hair. If this was a dream, the field would be water already, my body naked. The curtains in the windows, something I could float on, froth of white, night-tinged waves. But there is no sea here, no quiet. My mouth is a pinned butterfly. I cut a stone out of the air. How pretty she is, they say, their noses singeing the glass. This next one is actually the only persona poem from a male perspective. It's from Chopin's perspective. It came from a wild card prompt from Rita. So this is the only male perspective in the thesis, which is interesting. And it's Chopin. The only thing you need to know is George is a woman. George is essentially his ex-wife. So he's not a man, but Chopin's ex-wife. And she pops up towards the end. It's called Chopin Plays His Last Concert. I am the unmarked graves dotting the Chaune des Puits, left over from when the land still erupted, steep, endless. Now at the bottom of the hillside, a garden, everyone suddenly here, hushed, the marigolds like a sea, three white dresses in the crowd, but not you. Last week I dreamed you were in a hot air balloon. The volcanoes below you dark as your mouth when it opened against mine. They told me you married another man, said he was like me, but not like me. Afternoon wind, I imagine George grasping the music sheets, her fingers coated with pollen, drops of honey unfurling from her lips. For the last time, applause, small talk, plates and saucers stacked up past my elbows. I study myself against the piano. Laughter, congratulations. You played so beautifully. My body bright and full of dust. It's also my longest poem as well. I write really short poems, so that's my longest one in the thesis as well. So these next two poems came from Lisa Respar's series class. We had to write a series for our final project, and I chose to write about a role-playing game from the 80s called Paranoia. Pretty much all you have to know is that it's set in a dystopian future. These two poems are kind of the right before this, the kind of the dystopia government. So the first one is called Decorative Arts. The first thing you slip into is a dress, florals cinched around your hips, mourning like a plum, your mother on the phone. Marriage is the country of laundry, the balcony heavened with clotheslines, rosemary chicken on the table by five. At the art gallery opening, the name of the bowl plucked from the Northern Song Dynasty ricochets from your mouth. What is this glaze? Is that a tree or peacocks in flight? You stumble up the stairs. Below your window, people break beer bottles on the pavement. Let the world wait for you. Let you not forget what hunger means. Shouting from the soaked street, a city on its knees. Riot vertebrae. You hate the animal's flesh, blood under your nails, float of goats in the field behind the house. You are a child, the edges of your hair a burnt candle, fingers flicking back and forth over the flame. When your father opens the front door, a needle on vinyl, dizzy Miss Lizzie, your mother a spell. You dream of ash, of birds with strange wings, thrum of feathers against your head. You hold out your hands, kiss every beating body. And this is my last one. Thank you so much for coming and listening. Come spring, come flesh, come bright earth. One, Anna is full of geese. Horses flood the meadows. their mouths muzzles of light. She is not allowed to touch them, only watch as they fade to poppies. She bathes in Perdusa, the bank heavy with monarchs. Her hair grazes mud and silt, water pearls around her feet. Two. In her mouth, vegetation, crickets, winged throat. She gathers a field of fish in her body, dense with night. Three. Persephone, full of longing and dark gulls, this is not the sea. Your face in the earth, your mother waiting for you, calling for you. In spring, you return to the hills, the grain, her. How ethereal you are, she says. How new everything is. Hades, so far away. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Sara, and I'm going to be introducing Annie Pittman. In a poem that we both love, Bob Hickok writes, "A Midwesterner can use the word truth, can sincerely use the word sincere. Never has anyone lived up to this statement as much as Annie Pittman." My first week in Charlottesville, I went out for drinks to get to know some of my new cohort better. It was still hot, and our clothes were sticking to us in that annoying way that makes you feel both sweaty and cold at the same time. I didn't really know anyone. I was exhausted from my move and already homesick. But by the end of the night, Annie was introducing me to people, stroking my hair, and telling me I smelled just like her sister. In every workshop, every afternoon coffee, every late night talk, Annie is a model of how to be a caring citizen of the world. Her warmth and generosity are matched only by her intelligence. Her language is precise, both musically and emotionally. And to read one of her poems is to let yourself be led into a strange, yet deeply familiar world, knowing you are in the hands of an expert guide. In Annie's poems, landscapes mirror our spirits, and our spirits in turn affect the landscape. There is an overall theory of connectivity at play in Annie's work. No moment, person, flora, or fauna exists alone. Each has their own unique humanity to be affirmed. Annie's great tenderness and gift for intricacy is evident even in poems that lay bare the nature of trauma. In Not Unbeautiful, she writes of a hand broken open in an act of rage. "I am trying to give you wings, your fist in my lap, a variegated peony." When she says, "Then, like I'm swallowing the sky, I swallow the sky," we believe her, because she is the kind of writer who earns not only your admiration of her craft, but also her trust with your heart. For Annie, the past and what we endure is not only worthy of examination, but in fact a window into the very soul of who we are and will become. Annie writes of the body and in the body. Her poems are both delicate and visceral, full of feral power and also vulnerability, and the knowledge that these are so often the same. In her hands, the ordinary is transmogrified and made miraculous, as in Cake, where she writes of a friend, "Today, you told me you cried in the donut shop, and I said your tears might be like sprinkles." It takes a great deal of magic to approach the ghosts of one's life and of the world as not only a force to be reckoned with, but also with the compassion to lay them finally to rest. We find this strength in Annie Pittman. Please welcome her.
Thank you so much, Sara. That was, oh, there's water up here, so I didn't need to bring my gallon. Thank you, Sara, that was beautiful. Can you guys hear me okay? Okay, because I'm like not gonna crouch, but the tall people are moving in now.
It's kind of surreal to be standing up here. Everybody's always like, time moves so fast, but it's so true. It moves so quickly. And I find myself wanting it to slow down right now. I'm filled with love and gratitude toward everyone who I've met here in this program, to Jane and Chris and everybody who makes what we do possible, to Jeb and Barbara, who made me coffee every morning this year before I went and taught this semester at 9 a.m., which was so sweet, and I needed it, you know? Also, I needed Barbara's smiley face. I'm so grateful to our professors, to Rita and Paul and Lisa and Debra and Greg, for being just so there, for pushing us always deeper into ourselves. Had some conversations with my peers where we just go, yeah, we've got like the best teachers. It's so true. And finally, I'm grateful for, did I say Lisa's name? Okay, I did. I'm really grateful for my friends and peers here. The second years, last year, were just wonderful and welcoming and encouraging. And the first years this year, great job bringing them in. They're wonderful. Couldn't have asked for a better cohort. And my class. So thank you all very much. So this first poem is, I just would like you to know that the Julia in the poem is not our own Julia, who graduated last year, who's wonderful, but I don't know quite as intimately as this Julia. And there's an epigraph in this poem from the Book of Ruth. This is girl love. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Ruth stood near perfect amid the rotting stalks, red-lipped and gathering stolen corn. Boaz gazed unaware for whom she gleaned the crops. Naomi urged by the field's edge, find him asleep on the threshing floor, uncover his feet and the land will be ours. There is a hunger only woman can yield, sacrifice of some bushel bruised, a making good of harvest seconds. Sweet brine and heady, I know my girlfriends by their scents, and if they haven't washed in days, a smell like dampened sugar, illusion of forgotten oil, hair separating as though wet. Growing pains when muscle would stretch the bone, our bodies racing out beneath us too fast. The ache's still here, always, though now we manage on our own. I obsess over peaches, learn to taste them in my sleep. When Julia had tissue from her breast removed, I held her gentle as the wound leaked through her cotton bra, all night rain on the room's small window. The lump on her chest was only fat, that blessed and benign, what we prayed for, still we pray for in the moon. Nights she would pull me close to her, the spoon of us on her twin bed, her breasts into my back into her belly and salt, sleeping in our bodies quiet. We were saving up oceans, steadying tide, for yet to come. This is the last time I will see you. I return to our apartment, packing what I need for a couple more nights on a friend's air mattress where you can't find me. The scarf from my sister, navy with white bicycles on it, light wheels in the blue cotton, stars I can wrap around my throat. Maybe another sweater, I think. It's the beginning of February, so cold. You're asking me questions. Am I coming home? Just grab essentials, I tell myself. A couple pairs of underwear, all pink, that dumb blush. Please don't tell them what I said. You say, and your eyes are filling with water mottled so dark I can hardly tell if you're even swimming behind them anymore, barely treading the black ocean of your own sorrow that's choking you and you've all but disappeared. I remember suddenly that there are knives in the kitchen, sleeping sharp in their little wooden block, a Christmas gift from my mother. I can almost see your shadow rise from the chair to reach them. I forget the sweater. There are knives. What you threw in your last fit, so fast, flying by my face, lay where it came to rest. Vitamin D capsules that burst from the bottle. Tiny golden spheres nest in the carpet like the 100 suns you've buried. This next poem is part of a series I've been working on, defenestration series. Defenestration, which is the act of falling out of a window or being pushed out of a window to one's death. But I'm exploring it in terms of what the window is as a symbol between the self and the rest of the world. So this is Defenestration Crush. I used to take Prozac. Now, I light the happiness chakra candle, which is blue, which seems funny because blue is a name we give to sorrow. Also funny because blue is the bright, clear cradle of the sky that holds the sun. Patchouli, labdanum, frankincense. It smells better than the love candle, better than the healing candle, too. Still, I think dark thoughts, that I'll probably die of smoke inhalation, fallen asleep with the bullshit candle burning. I think of asphyxiation every time I light a candle, bullshit or otherwise. I didn't always think about death this much, but now I'm certain each plane ride is my last. I learn the name of the strangers I sit by on a flight, not because I'm friendly, but because I'd like to know the name of the person I'll die next to. I observe the aerial view of cities at night, their streams of light chasm, webs of the distant, smalled electric flames of pilgrims who go on bearing torches, lamps, and streetlights, headlights. And I know they're not pilgrims, just people, but sometimes it's religion just to keep living. Threats are sometimes worse, my friend says, because they're never realized. And so, some days, all day, I'm dying the way he said I would. Would you like to spend your life with me? I asked once, and he said, I want to die with you. I don't care so much if my possessions melt down, come into ash, if the pink fish of my own lungs suffocate in the alien air. But I don't want to hurt the immigrant families who live in the boxes that surround mine. How we've all traveled to get here, the ocean a mouth, and the mouth an ocean. I worry about the boy in the apartment below mine. Last fall, from my window, I watched him awe a cicada. Watched then another crush it and listen to silence in the space of why. And I worry over another boy who smashed a glass bottle in the parking lot, then looked up and met my gaze, the only other person around, to hear the magnificent sound of someone who only wanted to feel what it was like to break something, not the shock of it broken. So, my papers are a little funny. Moving from the ocean to the river, and the river that's been present in my work here is the Rivanna. So I'd just like to give some props to the Rivanna for being. I don't know where to go, so I go to the river to cast my sorrow out. On the beach across from me, winter gathers her things. Menagerie of dried bramble, bouquets of ghost flowers with ghost heads, silver once blossoms fractaling like the skeletal arms of stars that reach for nothing. On the bank where I stand, strung from the bare bark of an arched oak branch, a swing cobbled from what some kids could find in summer. Blue and white rope and a metal bar, it hangs now out of place, knotted, fraying, trapeze with no knuckles to grasp its slender shape, no ass to sit atop and press into, spill over and around it. Oh, grief thing, emptied of purpose. And me, my love's not dead, but he's gone. I have no body to anoint, no big hands to balm, torso to wrap in linen, nor any of the body below the torso. Let me speak with reverence here, not desire, though I'm not sure of the difference. No body to see into the earth but my own. Yesterday, and hundreds of miles from here, my hunter brother and his buddies emerged from their duck blind, walked a few yards west on the shore, and found a local girl who'd been missing a week. The police said she was pilled up when she wandered into the cold night alone. I hope it was gentle when they unlimbed her from the weeds at the lip of the lake where she was curled, elbows and knees tucked to hold on to the warmth at her center, her body a small blonde star closing in. Satsuma. You say you miss bringing sweet things to me from the grocery store, where you worked long hours carrying fruit in your apron pockets. Often, the cold hardy satsuma, weight of small mandarins bouncing at your groin while you walked the aisles. You drive the long, pine-bordered road home at night that always surprised us with its darkness. Tired and careless, you'd forget the citrus for days. By the time you remembered, the oranges had taken to mold. Small worlds shunned under gray-blue powder. I still have not mailed off your things. Boxes of books, gloves, and health insurance forms. I pitch objects I'm most attached to. The frame belt you tightened at your hips, those sockets I loved to press my thumbs into and watch you writhe. Some things I burn immediately. Sheets, towels, silhouettes of your Henleys in the giveaway pile that once opened the pale V of your chest. When I went back to the apartment for the first time after you left, among your dust and articles, a rotting satsuma in a blue ceramic bowl. I held it in my hand. I threw it into the forest. Okay, two more. This is Ars Poetica, Failing, for Victoria. Tonight, as I'm tending my pages, the power goes out. The whole complex, even streetlights, put to rest. Here at the edge of town, the mountains are just silhouetted lumps on what, in a few hours, we'll call horizon. I've forgotten what this kind of quiet will do to a body. I take a sponge bath at the sink. How false the flashlight seems, propped on a towel rack and shining in the bathroom mirror. Too white, like those new halogen headlights I hate. And as they might find strewn on the side of the highway, I am a speckled fawn, when dried bits of toothpaste on the mirror are reflected as tiny shadows against my bare chest, dappling my breasts with astral matter, falling tangles of my hair moon bramble, nipples flecked planets of rust, skin constellated into something beautiful, something I'm trying to love. Surely, there's a metaphor here about having no light as I tie the ends of my poems together like prayer flags. What I'm trying to find the right passage of light into, what I'm not saying is that V is still dying. On the way to the doctor's office, the morning she learned the prognosis, she sent me a picture of the sunrise, sky swelling with pink as the cancer was doing in her head. that quiet awakening. Now it's climbing down her brainstem, and each visit the doctor hands her new scans of grief, less time, and now I am angry at the first dumb flowers of this spring, how quickly they've already dried. V says she didn't know it would hurt when her hair fell out, didn't expect to feel each strand abandoning its follicle. Tell me, what lights here? What sacred growth, my friend on the table where they radiate her skull, cells blooming her crown, my words can't touch. Not enough to kiss the biopsy scars, as if my lips could somehow take her back pre-op, back to the place of unknowing, as if darkness unprodded is easier than the darkness we name. Last one. Thank you everyone for being here. Thank you for everything. Not looking for hope. Today, in the deluge of rain, dragged in from the coast, from the hurricane, I was waiting for the bus with a stranger. And when the bus passed us, without even a glance from the driver to the shelter where we stood, the stranger and I started running to catch it at the next stop down the road. And when I fell back with exhaustion in the pouring rain, raining harder, the stranger slowed to see if I was beside him. And when he saw that I wasn't, he turned back, swooped his head through the thick air like a sea, as if to say, we can make it. And we did.
I first met Rob Shapiro at the potluck that the second year poets host for incoming students. I was feeling that particular kind of tear that only someone who is old enough to be everyone else's mother can feel. Not that the others in the room weren't terrified too, since we all know that poets are a notoriously shy tribe. Which is why I'll never forget how Rob made a point of coming over to talk to me. Indeed, how he did everything in his power to make me feel at home. Which is sort of what Rob's poetry does. Warm and inviting, narrative yet full of song, Rob's poems are beautiful laments for home. For what we all long for, our people and our place in the world. Nature plays a big part of this in his work. Loved landscapes that he renders in ways that capture both the physical and the emotional worlds. Like lush woods covered in kudzu. The speakers of Rob's poems are old souls. They're lyrical time travelers, tender detectives, a loving magnifying glass in their hands, searching for those singular moments that help define us all. I can't tell you what a pleasure it's been to work with Rob this year, to find in him a kindred spirit, someone for whom poetry often begins as homesickness, then somehow becomes the way home. Please welcome Rob Shapiro.
Thanks, Robin. I'm Rob. I'm going to thank everyone too, Jeb and Barbara and my family for being here, all the professors, Paul and Rita and Greg and Debra and Lisa, just Jane and Chris for being our fearless leaders, and also just my classmates. I think, I just so admire everyone's work, but it's one thing to be working with talented people, and it's another to work with warm people and generous and kind people. So thanks for that. So I'm going to start with the first poem I wrote here, for whatever reason. So this is called On Easter. By now, the days are getting long. Damp white skies rowing over the hills, over the dim sun and starlings that circle neighbors' chimneys, rise. My stepfather piles the limbs and logs in the front yard, timber torn down during last month's ice storm, that forced families to sleep in cars along the interstate, huddled together for warmth. I come home to fire, to smoke lifting up in dark spirals. My stepfather paces the lawn, red gas jug snug against his hip, before tossing streams of diesel fuel on the flames, the billow leaping up above his head, spitting cinders, turning black. He keeps the fire alive through nights so quiet, there's only the rustling of wet wood being scorched. The dogs hide all day, return late to be fed or find a place to sleep, as thick fog lies across the lawn, conceals the silt of early spring, the eddy climbing into the clouds. For 3 days, the fire burns until nothing is left but roots and ash and rust-colored clay. Tonight, my stepfather and I open the windows, let the house fill with smoke and soot. We wait for rain, the pond to overflow. We look out into the darkness, into the charred plot of earth still glowing, hot with embers, half expecting life to grow back before us, renew. This is called November Pastoral. And even though I don't care about horses, I say I like how they stand side by side, because it's true. I like how they graze those big pastures, swatting flies out of each other's eyes with their knotted tails, flanks quivering and covered in frost. Each time we drive past, my sister slows to wash them, and I wonder if she remembers those winter nights, driving from one parent's house to the other, radio low, snow falling around us, our need for each other that quiet, that easy. Here, the grasses are dying, but they still flicker when the wind gets going and sunlight sifts down through the trees. The horses never turn around to leave, to gallop into that wingspan of bramble at the bottom of the hill. No, they just stand there together, kicking up sod and shaking their muzzles, waiting for someone else to appear, to call their names, to usher them in and away from the road. This one is called Photograph, Massachusetts, 1994. It's still spring there. Elms fill the backwoods, black-capped chickadees nest and feed. Hands cuffed to his knees, my father wades deeper into the pond, catching bullfrogs the way he did as a boy on Long Island. My grandfather is still alive and takes my small hand in his at the water's lip, the pond skin thick and glinting, olive and gold scum gathering at the surface. His shirt is pressed, his arms tan and strong, and I want to remember what happens next, why we're turning around to walk back up that hill, head home. I want to piece those hours back together, watch the afternoon break, bluebells waving in the tall grass, my father's waterlogged steps following us, leaving the schools of tadpoles to scatter beneath plumes of silt and algae. My grandfather lifts me to his chest, and a breeze picks up from the east. A fawn bolts through the brush at the field's edge, its young body disappearing into the deep thicket just behind us, just now beginning to bloom. This is another photograph poem. So this one is called Photograph, North Carolina, 2005. See the spring light beating down, the shadows pooling in the yard, how my mother tilts her chin back and folds her hands. Meeting for the first time, see how happy the two of them look together, my mother and stepfather, the world so green behind them. Her eyes pinch at the corners like maybe she's laughing, and now he smiles back. Someone points a camera, the shutter clicks. I must be up north, sailing across town on my bike, or watching TV with my sister, and in this moment, I hope my mother has forgotten us. I hope she's thinking instead about the sunlight nesting in the trees, the stranger at her side, his two boys and their farmhouse out in the country, the stillness he must feel walking those pastures each morning, beneath the sky, pale as linen, the cicadas surging, fog gathering around his boots. As she turns her head to speak, I want her to imagine she's alone again, just for a minute, just long enough to consider where this man came from and how suddenly the heart can fill, how sometimes the day turns so bright it almost hurts to look. I do this little thing with my students where I make them think of things they're experts in and then come up with like jargon that they know from them. And I was thinking, I was like, that's a pretty good assignment, maybe I should do that. So I did that. So this is like a baseball pun. So this is called Pitcher Game Day. I avoided mirrors, my mother packing her china, the summer rain outside. I laced my cleats and watched film, practiced my slide step in the basement. Blood blisters ran like wax along my fingernails, red welts from the ball's rough seams, and I thought of coach telling me to piss in my palm, toughen the skin, to burn a safety pin clean, and to get down beneath the flesh, drain that awful ache. I listened for thunder, plates rattling, a pulse in my ears. I listened for my own voice saying, paint the corners, change speeds, saying nothing hurts until nothing did. This next one's for my stepfather who's here, which is exciting. So, here you go. So this is called Venison. You tell me to hold the dog by his collar so he gets a good look, nose to nose with the upturned deer. You nick the ankles with your knife and fold the doe's fur back, peel away the skin in a single strip to reveal meat and bone, dark corona spreading from the clot. You could do this with your eyes closed, I think, as you make the next cut, call it a gut shot, tell me it'll be messy. Steam rises through the night from the slice of the pelt as moonlight falls into the barn beside us. I can smell the innards, the musk and iron, still fresh, still warm. Blood rushes into the tin you've set down at your feet while light punches through the holes left by the shot. One in, two out, big ribs broken, your bullet fragmented into buckshot scrap. Sharp knife, hacksaw, cold hands I'm learning to admire. You hose down what's left and let the dog lap at the rosy water running back into the night where the dirt, too frozen to turn, will not breathe. You remove the shoulders, the cutlets, the back straps, the blood beneath your nails, so red it's black. I make myself stay until you say you're through, until I've memorized how the veins fan out, the heart-shaped hips splay, how your hands move gently inside that deep chest to strip the deer clean, to show me what's tough and what's tender. This is called After Exodus. Wingless, marrow spent, the sun a white flame pinned to sky. Imagine how it felt to die there. Paradise so close, you could cover it with your thumb and make it vanish. Before the angel claimed his corpse, did gulls flock there, float over his rough body? Did a breeze bury his tracks in those dunes, unmake each step he took? Maybe he saw the river laying down before him, like a mirage cradled between banks. Maybe he looked away from the city, bright jewel planted at the Jordan's lip, sun-bleached, walled off, impossible to enter. It must have hurt to see such light from the mountain's top, to smell salt drift in on the voices of fishermen, bells ringing inside the desert's tiny heart. Dying there must have felt familiar, bulrushes rippling, heaven outstretched, a sound like a sea, parting. And this is my last one. And it's called Yonder. When the last rifle shots of the season ring out across the river, swollen thick with rain and mud, moving forward as everything must, snow glistens along the bank's dark crown, and you understand nothing changes in these parts. Not the smell of wood smoke or January's damp air, the top-heavy sky working its way overhead. It's a new year, and by now you know better than to make resolutions, though you wish you could move like those gold-rimmed clouds, your body half a heaven, drifting someplace easier. It's almost enough to linger on the porch this evening, imagining the wind up there, the rafters of stars hidden above. You would wheel over Earth's edge, wade across the blushed horizon. You would ferry this light from one place to the next. Thank you.
Thank you, friends. thank you faculty, thank you family. And I think we have some mementos of this event up here, some copies of Meridian and the poster commemorating this evening and tomorrow evening. So come back tomorrow. Thanks, everyone. The standards are higher for my quiz. I have to remember to call it.